When Mary Duke Biddle Trent Semans was born, Duke University was no more than a twinkle in her great uncle's eye. But Mary's been a twinkle in the eye of this university ever since. And not just this university, but this city, this state, and far beyond. And we've gathered together today because she put a twinkle in our eye too. We've come together to hand her over to God, that she might be a twinkle in God's eye forever. Let us pray. Loving God, you see the twinkle in our eye, and you see the tears also. As you gave us the joy and the companionship of life with Mary, give us now the courage and the hope to live without her. As you gave us abundant life through her life, give her abundant life through yours, that she may be the apple of your eye and abide in your everlasting arms, now and always. Amen. Let us worship God.
Thank you.
seated. I'm going to read about two people who both, like Mary, were well on in years, who both symbolized their people, and who had both spent their lives longing for the redemption of their society. The story tells how they rejoiced to see salvation in the shape of a tiny baby. I believe we can see Mary's life through the window of theirs. The gospel is taken from Luke chapter 2. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when Mary and Joseph brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshipped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. Simeon says to God, "My eyes have seen your salvation." We're here today because Mary Semans was an agent of God's salvation, because she was a woman who helped us see salvation in education, in art, in civil rights, in medicine, in horticulture, in music. Because of Mary Semans, each one of us can say, better than we otherwise could have, "My eyes have seen your salvation." We celebrate that. What a wonderful thing to be able to say. But that's not the real reason why we're here. The real reason why we're here is because of something else Simeon says, this time to Jesus' mother, Mary. Simeon says, "And a sword will pierce your own soul too." The real reason we're here today is because Mary Semans was a sword that pierced our own souls. Pierced our souls with her kindness, pierced our souls with her wisdom, pierced our souls with her honesty, pierced our souls with her courage, pierced our souls with her fierce, indomitable, irrepressible, enduring spirit, pierced our souls with her love. Thank you, Lord God, for the gift of Mary Semans. She showed us your salvation, and she pierced our souls with love.
Duke University welcomes you to this celebration of our beloved Mary Semans. This institution and Mary were so intertwined that neither really had a life apart from the other. Mary was a young member of the Duke family when Duke University came into being. The West and East campus of this university were built while she was still a child. She moved to Durham full-time when she was 14, in other words, a year before Duke Chapel was even completed. At 15, she enrolled as a student in the Woman's College. From this start and throughout her life, she loved this university, she knew pretty much everything that ever happened here, and she gave her support to every act that ever took Duke forward. But though she had a profound institutional impact, in Mary's case, good works took an entirely personal form. I remember how it started with me. On a December day in 2003, quite a stranger to this school, I was announced as the president who would come and succeed Nan Cohan. After the news conference, I was taken on a kind of victory lap to meet the greats of Duke University, a great cancer surgeon, a great basketball coach, a few other greats. As the tour drew to its close, my guide told me with evident excitement that it was going to work out for me to meet one more of Duke's giants, Mary Semans, our chief link to Duke's founding family. Pardon me if I say, at this time, Mary's name was actually not as well known to me as Coach K's was. And from this brief account, this brief introduction, what was I expecting to meet? I was expecting to meet a grande dame, or perhaps even a kind of local royalty. Mary, Duke, Biddle, Trent, Semans, mere commoners do not have five names. And from this expectation, when I met her, I was not entirely disappointed. When I was taken in to meet Mary, now I have to draw on some words from the novelist Henry James, I knew that this lady had the air of being someone in particular. Such a sparkle in those eyes, such stylishness in that presentation. Weren't you delighted looking on the Duke website to see that the picture used to commemorate Mary is of her in shocking yellow with the skirt shockingly short? As we say here in Durham, not afraid of flavor. But if Mary cut a figure, as she undeniably did, haughtiness was no part of the equation. When I got to the room where Mary was, Cindy and our son Dan had already been with her in her company for 10 or 15 minutes. And when I came in, these three were going at it a mile a minute, moving from one shared pleasure to another as if they had known each other for 100 years. So I got the idea. Mary had engaged them. She had taken outsiders and made them feel quite at home. And at the end of 2 minutes, she had done the same for me. I dwell on this memory because if Mary's work will live on partly through the institutions she supported, Duke University, the Duke Endowment, the University of North Carolina School of the Arts, the civic and cultural activities she supported in Durham, her effect arose from her unique skill at personal relationships, the way she imbued each individual encounter with the fullness of her grace, her attention, and her love. Did you ever receive a thank you note from Mary? I received dozens, each one of which made me feel like I was being fully appreciated for the first time in my life. When Mary took Cindy and me to see the 50th anniversary production of West Side Story at the School of the Arts, she singled out each young performer for the sincerest, warmest, and most discerning appreciation. I've been studying up on Mary's leadership of the civil rights movement in Durham. As you know, as a widowed mother of four, she was one of the first two women elected to the city council, elected in the same year as the integrationist mayor, Mutt Evans. Later, she became the leader with Elna Spalding of the cross-racial group called Women in Action for the Prevention of Violence and Its Causes. But these civic acts were built on personal acts of engagement and appreciation, friendships Mary had built person by person across artificial social divides. And not just racial divides with Mary, but all divides. Because who hasn't heard stories the last few days of Mary stopping someone in the grocery store aisle to embrace them or ask how their family is, or even Mary flying in to visit some local merchant to find out how business was? If you knew Mary, then you mattered. When Mary Semans was honored at the National Museum 2 years back, I found a phrase, and I've struggled and struggled, but I haven't been able to improve on it. To me, Mary Semans was the embodiment of unconditional love. She saw more good in others than any of us are used to imagining in ourselves, and when you were with her, you wanted to be that better person she believed in so fully. She made this city, this university, and this region better in actuality by the way she believed in their possibility. She couldn't help it. That's just what it was like when you were Mary D.B.T. Semans. Lucky us to have been part of the world that Mary Semans loved and made.
Well, it was a lucky day for North Carolina when Mary Semans, I thought at age 15, but I now know at age 14, came to Duke University, to the family home in Durham, where she raised this wonderful family, which has done so much for North Carolina and for our nation. Many will speak today of her kindness and generosity. I want to speak of her public spirit and involvement. In her days as a young mother, as just said, she became a public citizen and leader in Durham. But she also soon became an important partner to governors and other public leaders in this state. While she and her family were always generous philanthropists, she knew that North Carolina could only be the state she wanted it to be if we set big goals. Goals for ourselves, brought our people, black, white, and Hispanic together, and committed the public resources to become great. She urged us to focus not so much on crafting tight budgets as developing young minds and talents. As chair of the North Carolina Executive Mansion Fine Arts Committee for decades, probably starting with Terry Sanford, been coming all the way forward, she embellished that great Victorian home. But what she really did was help all the governors who lived there, whether they wanted her help or not. She urged us to constantly move our state forward in education, in health care, in the arts, in fairness and opportunity for all of our citizens. And when she first started, they didn't have it, and they still don't. When we as governors, Governor Perdue and all of them here today could tell you this, when we as governors needed to validate a progressive initiative to build North Carolina, there was no better way than to say, Mary Semans is for it. And if we weren't moving fast enough, we'd probably see Mary somewhere. Maybe sit down in a quiet corner, and Mary would fix our eyes with that kind but steely look and encourage us to work harder, to do more. And if we did, as President Brodhead mentioned, we were apt to get a handwritten note thanking us. I won't ask you to raise your hands, But have you ever gotten one of Mary's notes? And the, yeah, they're going up, especially with these grandchildren and great-grandchildren. I still have the last one she sent to me. When you read it, you felt like you were king of the world. I don't care if every newspaper in North Carolina was cussing you. Mary said you were doing good. And you went out and did more. Today, all of us here in this great Duke Chapel should resolve to do more. To make us in North Carolina and America all that we can be and should be and must be. That's what Mary would want.
Good afternoon. It is indeed an honor and my solemn privilege to be asked by the family to speak on behalf of the Durham City Council in memoriam of Mrs. Mary Duke Biddle Trent Semans, one of the pillars of our community. So many great, nice things have been said about Mrs. Semans, who so often asked you to simply call her Mary. I'm sure more will be said today and in days to come about her as a person and of her many contributions. And I'm not sure today that I can add any more profound remarks to what is being said or has been said in honor and memoriam. On occasions such as this, I'm sure that probably most of you in attendance have your own personal recollections of Mary, which have been brought back to you since her passing. Many have said that when they met Mrs. Semans, they felt an immediate connection, as though they already knew her. Well, I count myself as one of those persons, and I remember quite vividly when I met her early on in my arrival in Durham in the late 60s, after having been introduced to her by my friend, the late Benjamin Ruffin. From her conversations, from her smile and her devotion to Durham, they were all very immediate, apparent to me. It was obvious that throughout her life, she felt a strong connection to Durham and Duke University. She knew our community and had an undying devotion to it, which accrued to the benefit of everyone who calls our great city home. I am personally very grateful for her leadership over the years, as she served on many civic and academic boards, and for her contributions to healthcare, to civil rights, to the arts, and to, I received some of those kind notes and telephone calls that she personally made, either thanking me for an action and giving me encouragement or giving me advice in her own general way on something that I might want to look into. Those, along with almost an infinite list of contributions, will be her legacy for generations to come. Truly, Mrs. Semans represented the heart, the goodness that is Durham. Where our hearts grieve for the loss of a compassionate and caring human being, we rejoice in knowing that she left an indelible mark on Durham that will forever shine. And frankly, I believe she's one of the persons responsible for making Durham a community that has been admired throughout the state, the nation, and the world. When asked to speak today at this service, I was reminded of a quote by the ancient Greek statesman Pericles, and he wrote, and I quote, "What you leave behind is not what is engraved in stone monuments, but is woven into the lives of others." I believe that we can all agree that the contributions made by Mrs. Semans during her lifetime are truly woven into each of us, and to the beautiful tapestry that makes Durham, that will make Durham. I also thought about the last time I had the privilege of spending some time alone with Mrs. Semans. My wife and I had attended a dinner at Roof and Victor Zile's home, and Governor, you and your wife were there, among others. And after the meeting, after the dinner, my wife offered to take Mrs. Semans home. And while the drive was not very long, it was an opportunity to hear so much about the history of Durham and how she thought it had changed for the best. She talked about her time with Mrs. Eleanor Spaulding, as has been mentioned earlier. She talked about how much she loved the city called Durham and wouldn't want to live any other place else. Afterwards, my wife and I remarked how down to earth she was, but yet so majestic in her appearance and speech, and how the sincerity of her comments radiated her affection for those things that she cared greatly about, such as Durham, Duke, her family, and the arts. To the 7 children, the 16 grandchildren, the 29 great-grandchildren of Mrs. Semans, there are so many accomplishments, so very many successes, a wealth of hopes and dreams fulfilled, days and days well lived, and now a legacy to celebrate. My sweet memories of the gem that was your mother, your grandmother, your great-grandmother, encourage you and comfort you from this point forward. And on behalf of this entire community, I say not in grief that your mother's gone, but always remain thankful that she was yours, for remain thankful that she was ours. And as I conclude my remarks, I'd like to say that I will be presenting a resolution memorializing Mrs. Semans at our next City Council meeting, Monday, February 6th. Again, thank you, and God bless. Bless.
Of the Durham Cowlers, we are very honored to have been asked to be a part of the homegoing services for our friend, Miss Mary Semans. And to the family, we love you.
Amazing. grace, amazing grace.
How sweet
the sound that saved a wretch,
saved a wretch like me.
Once was lost,
but
now I'm found, I was blind, but now I see.
Someday,
one of these old days,
someday,
my God's gonna separate the right from the wrong.
Someday,
my God's gonna move all over this land. Nobody but the righteous will be able to stand. My God's gonna separate the right from the wrong.
Someday,
one of these old days,
someday,
my God's gonna separate the right from the wrong.
Someday,
my God's gonna move all over this land. Nobody but the righteous will be able to stand. My God's gonna separate the right from the wrong.
Someday,
I wanna be ready.
Ready.
Oh yes, I wanna be ready
when Jesus comes.
I wanna be ready. I'm gonna be
ready when Jesus comes.
I'm going where the wicked will cease from troubling, and the weary shall be at rest. My God's gonna
separate the right from the wrong. Someday,
I wanna be ready. Oh God, I wanna be
ready when Jesus comes.
I wanna be ready. I'm going where the wicked will cease from troubling, and the weary shall be at rest. My God's gonna
separate the right from the wrong. Someday.
Oh, separate.
Separate the right from the wrong.
Separate.
Separate the right from the wrong.
Separate.
Separate the right from the wrong.
My God's gonna move all over this land. Nobody but the righteous will be able to stand. My God's gonna
separate the right from the wrong.
Someday.
A woman of valor who can find. Her worth is beyond pearls. She girds herself with strength and braces her arms for the tasks. She reaches out her palm to the poor and extends her hand to the needy. She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the law of kindness is on her tongue. She watches over the ways of her household and never eats the bread of idleness. Charm is deceptive and beauty vain. It is the God-fearing woman who deserves praise. Give her the reward she has earned. Let her deeds bring her praise in the gates. That is from Proverbs 31. Good afternoon, President Brodhead, Dean Wells, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, especially to Mary's children, Mary Jones, Sally Harris, Becky Kirkland, Barbara Kimbrell, Jenny Kurtbajian, James and Beth, and the grandchildren and great-grandchildren. Our hearts go out to all of you. May your mother's memory and your grandmothers and great-grandmothers be always a blessing for you and for your generations to come. How Mary did all she did while at the same time raising and nurturing 7 children is a miracle in itself. But each of her children will readily attest to the loving care they continuously received from their amazing mother. And not a small part of that ability is due to the collaborative partnerships which she enjoyed with her late husbands, Joe Trent and Jim Semans, and the skilled and devoted associates, both past and present, who work with her daily. And to Mary's staff at the Mary Duke Biddle Foundation, Doug Zinn and Kathy Harrison and their colleagues, all of whom helped make it possible for Mary to do all that she did, we express to you our gratitude and to you all our heartfelt condolences. We come here today to mourn a truly profound loss, the death of our beloved Mary Semans, who touched the lives of every one of us, directly and indirectly, through all that she did, year in, year out, day in, and day out. I pray that each of us will draw strength from her literally unique example of a life consistently lived with the express purpose to benefit others. Let this moment of grief over the loss we share arouse a resolve in each of us to strive with all our might to emulate some aspect of Mary's unique human magnanimity as she devoted her life to the communities of Duke, Durham, the Triangle area, North Carolina, and the wider world beyond. I'd like to focus my remarks on Mary as a philanthropist, which is both easy and impossible to do, because what Mary did as a philanthropist was seamlessly related to who Mary was as a human being. As Mary herself said in an interview 15 years ago, philanthropy is an attitude. It's a dedication to the people around you. The mark of a great philanthropist who seeks to achieve maximum impact in philanthropy is wholehearted immersion in the initiatives which they support, while meticulously respecting the autonomy of their partners who are implementing those initiatives. In other words, the great philanthropists throw themselves, not only their money, but even more important, their time, their energy, their ideas, their friends, their contacts, their love, and their vision into the initiatives to which they give financial support. And Mary was among the greatest of them all in doing so. Mayor Bell is exactly right in describing Mary as the heart of Durham, but she was also the heart and soul of Duke, and not only in the arts. Every one of us in this great cathedral experienced Mary's love in many ways. Permit me to say a personal 2 words about how I did. As a Jewish member of the Duke faculty, I was struck by Mary's persistent efforts to add to Duke University programs and facilities to enable Jewish students to observe and strengthen their religious practices while benefiting from a superb Duke education. When former Durham Mayor Emmanuel Evans in 1971 proposed the establishment of a Duke UNC Chapel Hill Center for Jewish Studies, Mary was a member of the planning committee for that effort. Many years later, when Duke agreed to solicit support from parents and alumni to build what is now the Freeman Center for Jewish Life, guess who volunteered to serve on the original governing board for that center? She was the only Methodist on there. Moreover, hers was not token support by simply lending her name. To everyone surprised, and I had it confirmed to me this week by one of the members, she regularly attended the meetings of the board. She solicited money for the enterprise, and thanks in part to Mary's support, both of those entities are thriving today. One more personal word. One important contribution Mary made to this university may well escape notice this afternoon, so let me be the one to note it here. Without question, it was Mary Semans who was responsible for persuading Terry Sanford to be a candidate for Duke's presidency in 1969, and whose advocacy of his candidacy persuaded the other Duke trustees to elect him to that post. It was pretty unusual then for a politician to be elected president of a distinguished university. And yet Duke did it, and the reason Duke did it was without question because of Mary Semans. To the end of her days, she remained proud of that achievement, which had such a profound effect on this university's trajectory in the world of U.S. higher education. These and many other aspects of Mary's legacy are all very important, but don't let the mile-high stack of Mary's achievements distract you from what made them possible, what powered them. For that, you must look inside her. If it is true, as Henry Ward Beecher wrote, that every artist dips his brush in his own soul and paints his own nature into his pictures, then the luster that leaps to eye from today's Duke is straight from Mary's soul. She was invariably kind to and gentle with everyone, regardless of their station in life. She lived to do good for others. Indeed, she lived for others. Her own life exemplified some of humanity's most praiseworthy ideals: the beauty of the arts, the protection of human dignity and equality, the furtherance of a lively, diverse, inclusive educational community, the advancement of the wider communities in which we all live. Even more important than what she did is what she was: an inspiration, an encourager, a cheerleader, and a comforter to all those in the Duke community and in the wider community who sought to bring about change for the better. As Tom Lambeth, Mary's longtime friend and admirer, exclaimed to me yesterday, "What a person glowing with all the richness of humanity, bent to the common good and to lighting up the world for all who encountered her and her gifts." Kind, gentle, and invariably humble. Even on the day that she was elected as Durham's first woman vice mayor in 1950, a position she held for 12 years, she couldn't bring herself to express pride in her achievement. She told Mayor Mud Evans' son Eli many years later that that was among the most exciting days of her life because she was, as she said, jumping in and going public into the arena, and even looking back, she said she had tried to say no several times. Her in local politics, how shocking it would be to her family and her friends. But she never once mentioned how proud she was of being elected mayor to pro tem, the first female in Durham's history to hold that position. She would never express pride. Humility was one of her deepest values. All of us know some part of the great good that Mary did and for the world, but her countless acts of kindness and generosity, large and small, to countless human beings, the lowly and the mighty, and the profound humility in which she gave them, only God himself has the bandwidth to keep track of each and every one. Henry Fielding observed 2.5 centuries ago, "There cannot be a more glorious object in creation than a human being replete with benevolence, meditating in what manner to render himself most acceptable to the Creator by doing good to his creatures." Shakespeare wrote in Measure for Measure, "Heaven doth with us as we with torches do, not light them for themselves. For if our virtues did not go forth of us, 'twere all alike as if we had them not." Magnanimity, thy name is Mary Semans. I was there the morning that Mary was to give the commencement address to the Duke class of 1983. The clouds were dark and threatening. Everyone thought it was going to rain, including the weatherman, until Mary stood up and took the podium. At that point, at that very point, the clouds parted. The sun came out bright and strong. The clouds all went away, as if to honor that woman of valor. In that speech, she urged the graduates to be examples of what she called compassionate living. "I am pleading," she says, "for an extraordinary devotion to humanity. In addition to your employment, do something that benefits the human condition. That was Mary's message to the graduates nearly 30 years ago, and that is her plea to us here today. Farewell, beloved and loving Mary. May flights of angels sing thee to the rest, to thy rest in the world to come. Thank you very much.
I can't help, as I look out at these wonderful family members and friends, that this would thrill Mary, and knowing her as well as I did, she would probably blush a little bit. All these people coming for me, but the love and energy in this chapel is overwhelming. Yes, there is an emptiness in my heart today, a void left by the passing of a very dear friend and a bright life in the lives of so many gathered here. My journey with this remarkable lady began when I was in the sixth grade Calvert Methodist School, where I attended and Mary's children. It's a long time ago, but I want to tell you, when the first time I met her and subsequent times at that young age, she was the same as she was to me a month ago. Vibrant, kind, loving, taking time. I mean, she never changed. She was just the same person through all these decades that I have known her. It wasn't long after that Mary and her children and grandchildren really became my extended family. She would also become a great mentor, and through her example and encouragement, I would begin to learn what philanthropy was all about, including the right way and the wrong way to go about it. Largely, because of her example and encouragement, I've had the privilege and honor of serving on many charitable foundations, including the wonderful Duke Endowment, the Mary Duke Biddle Foundation, the Semans Art Fund, and the very small but precious Mary Duke Biddle Trent Semans Foundation, which very few people even know about, but it's a very special one. Now, much to Mary's pleasure and my own, Mary's children and even some of her grandchildren are taking up the mantle and working in those same organizations to continue their mother and grandmother's stewardship, which made her terribly proud. Though we work together for many great and worthy causes, my greatest joy was following in her footsteps, working in support of an institution that she helped establish, the University of North Carolina School of the Arts. Now, Mary may have been married to Duke University, and I think she was, but she loved the University of North Carolina system of public higher education. She talked about it several times. In the last year or two, she was very proud. She loved Duke immensely, but she was proud of the state system, the oldest public university, public supported university in the country. She was enormously proud of that. Mary and her husband Jim poured all of their energy into this first publicly supported conservatory to include music, dance, and drama, and later to add schools of design and film. Mary herself, almost single-handedly, with the help of Jim, established the International Music Program, which allowed the brightest stars of the music programs of the School of the Arts and other leading conservatories the chance to spend their summer break touring and performing across Italy. Inspired by Mary and Jim's efforts, my own father, who was an early founder and member of the board of the school, suggested that I go along pro bono to assist and help wherever I could. Well, you know, you don't refuse your father, and you don't refuse Mary when she says, come on along with us. With orchestras of 60 to 80 musicians in tow, opportunities to help were never in short supply. The School of the Arts, as it was originally called in the early years, was often referred to as the impossible dream, because so many of the founders, Terry Sanford, John Ely, they said, this is really going to be a very hard nut to crack, and I don't know whether we can really get this going. But Mary frequently, in past years, would say, oh, the impossible dream. Mary made this dream come true. Her skill in building and leading was truly remarkable, and besides my father, I think I learned the most from Mary. They both loved each other. They both worked in philanthropy, but they were different. But Mary was, well, she was different. I could never say no. If she said, I want you to try this, do that, I just did it, and I never regretted it. This year would have been the 38th year that Mary and I would have found ourselves seated at the same table at the School of the Arts in Winston-Salem, listening to students, artists, faculty, staff, and many chancellors. She would follow the careers of these students, and she never stopped giving support. It was just amazing. Often she would say to me, do you remember so-and-so? He was a violinist. He's now in Chicago. I wrote him a letter. I think I'm going to send him a little birthday present because he's having a rough time. Really, she knew the names. When Mary would walk across the campus, I felt so embarrassed because she was calling John, Mary, Sue, Philip. She knew them all. I knew a few, and then they all came rushing up to her. She was the beautiful and magnificent Pied Piper of Hamlet. The students just flocked to her, and you're going to hear some of the students today. The school, two busloads of students and faculty and staff came down today. It is a tearful day at the School of the Arts, but we can smile and sing because of her. She will always be considered the mother of the University of North Carolina School of the Arts. She was the bright light that led the way in the school's founding and would continue for more than 45 years as the leading advocate for support of this amazing, impossible dream. It's now up to those who knew and loved her to see that her light continues to shine. As these wonderful speakers preceding me said, to shine brightly in the wonderful legacy that she leaves behind. As you leave this chapel to embrace her family, may we commit ourselves to keeping Mary's memory alive and vigorous by striving as she did just to make the world a little more beautiful and a little more welcoming place to everyone in it. Thank you so much.
impossible dream to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, to love pure and chaste from afar, to try when your arms are too weary, to reach the unreachable star. This is my quest, to follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right, without question or cause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know, if I'll only be true to this glorious quest, that my heart will lie peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest. And the world will be better for this, that one man scorned and covered with scars, still strong with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable star.
Tom Keenan said it already, but I can't help but say that apart from the praise of Mary, Mary would have loved every bit of this. Let us pray. O God, who art the strength of thy saints, and who redeemest the souls of thy servants, we bless thy name for all those who have died in the Lord and who now rest from their labors, having received the end of their faith, even the salvation of their souls. Especially today we call to remembrance thy loving kindness and thy tender mercies to thy servant Mary. For all thy goodness that withheld not her portion in the joys of this earthly life, and for thy guiding hand along the way of her pilgrimage, we give thee thanks and praise. We ask thy blessings upon her family, those she loved so dearly, and in whom she took endless delight, and for whom she exhibited patience and pride. We call to mind especially Joe Trent and Jim Semans, her daughters and son, her grandchildren and great-grandchildren. Raise up in those who remain the spirit of love and generosity Mary unfailingly exhibited and sought to inspire in us all. In this passing of an era, uphold those of us, her legions of friends, and kindle in us her sense of obligation to others and our communal life. We bless thee, O Lord, for Mary's love of the arts, her commitment to the North Carolina School of the Arts, the very beginnings of the Duke Art Museum and its evolution into the Nasher, her extraordinary commitment to musicians, artists, and all those who make our world more humane. We praise thee, O Lord, for Mary's commitment to the civic life, to the two Carolinas, and especially North Carolina, our city of Durham, her passion for bringing people together, and her advocacy for the rights and dignity of all people. We give special thanks, O Lord, for her extravagant love of Duke University and her exceptional decades of service to the Duke Endowment. Her loyalty and faithfulness kept these institutions sound and looking to the future, even while staying true to the founding vision. Mary always showed up. There are so many things we will miss: her sense of style that delighted and amused us, her florist bills, her joy of life that always made us feel better for having encountered her, her habit of paying attention to everyone she met, regardless of his or her station in life, and never forgetting an encounter. Most of all, we praise thee, O Lord, for Mary's generous heart, vitality, and fundamental goodness, for her love of thy dear name, and for thy church that enabled her to fight the good fight, to endure unto the end, and to obtain the victory. We magnify thy holy name that her trials and temptations being ended, sickness and death being past, with all the dangers and difficulties of this mortal life, her spirit is at home in thy presence, with whom dwelleth eternal peace. Remember thy servant Mary, O Lord, and grant that increasing in knowledge and love of thee, she may go from strength to strength in the life of perfect service in thy heavenly kingdom. All of this we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end. And now we all join in the prayer Christ taught his church. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
bring Mary, O Lord God, at her last awakening, into the house and gate of heaven, to enter into that gate and dwell in that house, where there shall be no darkness nor dazzling, but one equal light, no noise nor silence, but one equal music, no fears nor hopes, but one equal possession, no ends nor beginnings, but one equal eternity, in the habitations of thy glory and dominion, world without end. Amen. Go forth upon your journey from this world, dear child of God, in the power of the Father who created you, into the hands of the Son who redeemed you, into the heart of the Holy Spirit who restores you. May the communion of saints enfold you, the company of angels behold you, and the heavenly hosts surround you. May peace be yours this day, and the heavenly city your home. Now, Lord, you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people, Israel. Amen.